Thanks, Chris. Okay, good morning, everybody, and thanks very much, Chris, for that introduction. Thanks for the opportunity to join Leaders Summit again. I think this is my third or fourth time. In the past, I've talked more specifically about the industry, but Chris asked me to talk about how marketing is changing and what that might mean for you and your organization. Why do we care about marketing? Well, that's really simple. Marketing is actually the key to discovering how you create value for customers, right? So we know that customers are the source of all the money, particularly with CDC. And so if we do a good job of creating value for customers, we get to get some of that money. And if we do a poor job of creating value, we lose them. So I think that's becoming very clear. And you saw some of the challenges that providers are facing in Steve's talk. And I'm going to touch on some of those as well. So this is really a general discussion about what I think is happening in marketing. Let's look at some of the changes. I consider there to be basically four tectonic shifts. By the way, how many marketers do we have in the room? Raise your hand if you're a marketer. All right, any idea what these tectonic shifts are in marketing? Why is marketing different from the way it used to be? Technology's one. Yep. Any other ideas? Consumer expectations. What's happening to them? Rising, falling? Yeah, they're rising, and they're rising exponentially. And why are they rising exponentially? Because they're experiencing new forms of value and disruption in lots and lots of industries, right? And not just ours. Let me see if I can summarize them for you. First one is massive fragmentation of customer engagement and communication channels. Used to be really simple. There was a handful of channels, handful of ways of reaching somebody. And today, that is not the case. Here's what's called the conversation prism. Now, you can't read that. Guess why you can't read that? These are all the channels people are using to search for information. They're channels people are using to figure out what to do about their choices, how to find things that mirror themselves and their own view of themselves, communicate with others, and transact and do a whole lot of other things. What's the problem with that slide?
Busy.
Busy, yeah, hard to read. You're getting a headache just looking at it? Well, the problem with that slide is a customer can go anywhere through that prism at any time, and they can choose any combination of channels in that prism at any time. And so if you're a marketer and you're trying to reach this person, what do you need to know? What do you need to know? How are they going through that prism, right? This is a really, really, really big issue, and most marketers' heads begin to explode when they think about that problem, because there's so many different permutations of how somebody would go through that prism. It's almost infinite. So what do we need from our customers then? If we want to effectively communicate with them in a highly fragmented world of communication and engagement, what do we need to know? How every single one of them is using that prism, right? And if we don't know that, guess what? We're out of the communication discussion. That's the first tectonic shift. And the challenge that I see in that is basically, how do we reach and communicate with customers who are active across that conversation prism? Tectonic shift number two. New tools for understanding customers. I'll say more about this in a minute. But basically, we now have ways of understanding what customers are trying to do and what their expectations are and what their preferences are and what their choice behavior is. Ways of understanding that that were inconceivable even a decade ago. So the technology's largely enabled that. And so we can do it now. Much easier to understand customers differently, even without asking them any questions, actually, by the way, just by observing them. And so if we can do it, somebody will do it. And so I think from a competitive point of view, the challenge is who of my competitors is going to take advantage of these new tools to understand their customers better than perhaps we do using these new technologies. We're interested in what's called the customer genome, We know everybody's mapping your literal genetic sequence, but we have a customer genome as well, which is a full picture of what the customer is interested in, what they're doing, what they're expecting, where they are in their journey, what the life moments and context is that might change their expectations. And the challenge for us is to understand that entire genome and do something effective with it that makes us relevant and unique in the eyes of the customer at a particular point in time. Now, Steve just talked about big data. Big data is becoming huge in aged care. This is the big data landscape. You know, there's lots of pictures of this. Another very busy slide. And the reason that slide is busy is because of what? This is an area of really high activity. Just to give you a sense of how important big data is, you're familiar with General Electric, correct? GE? Anyone know their business? What's their business? They're a manufacturing company. They make aircraft engines, turbines, all sorts of things, medical equipment. They used to have another business called finance. Finance was about half their profit. What did they do in the last 3 years? They sold the finance business and created another business. What's the other business? The other business is a data business, big data business. They've gone from 30 employees to 30,000 employees in that business in less than 3 years. What does that business do? Their big data business. It sits down with somebody like you and shows you what we can do with the Internet of Things, which is, you know, devices picking up information all over the place. And it shows you what you can do with that data, what kind of data you can collect, what you can do with it to create new experiences for customers. Now, I think that's a pretty good indication of where they think the future of competition is going to lie. It's going to lie in who has the best data and who knows how to make the most sense of that data. It isn't going to lie in who has the best product. That's just a necessary condition for being in business. So GE is making a really huge commitment in this. We're seeing a lot of this. Steve, in his talk, began discussing big data and the need to collect great data around the well-being of somebody in aged care. There's a company I know in San Francisco called Frog Design. They're like IDEO, they're a product design company. They've designed a kinetic lamp. The kinetic lamp is just a machine, it's a light, sits in the home of somebody in aged care and is collecting all of the data about the health and well-being of that person remotely. If the person is healthy, the lamp stands tall. If the person is not feeling so well, the lamp begins to shrink. And if the person is in an urgent care situation, the lamp goes off and sends a signal to somebody else to come and help. Now, these kinds of devices are going to appear everywhere. And they're going to be really, really important for somebody who's getting care at home. Because they have no way of telling somebody if something bad happens. So this is all an example of what's going to happen with big data. And there are many, many companies interested in this space. And I think you're going to see a lot of innovation in the care industry around big data. So the big question is, how do we use big data to identify new customer insights and deliver new customer experiences? We'll come back to that in a minute. The third shift is the shift from what I call product-centric views of competition to ecosystem views. Again, the people in Frog Design and IDEO, they're my students. One of them said to me the other day, look, Peter, 10 years ago, we would have a client. A client is a big company like NAB or Telstra. And they would come to us and say, help us design a new product. Great. 10 years ago, 90% of that design work was around products. Today, only 10% of that design work is around products. Today, we spend 90% of our time designing customer experiences. What's the difference between designing a product and designing a customer experience? What's the difference? That's really simple. Designing an experience starts with the highest level view of a customer problem or aspiration that you can identify. You step it right up to the very top, let the customer define for you what the highest level problem is that they have or the highest level dream or aspiration that they have, and then you map everything in that journey that would solve that problem. And when you start mapping everything that would solve that problem, what do you very quickly discover? You very quickly discover that you have one small piece of that experience. They did one of these journey mappings for the train system in Italy. They found there were 34 touch points in the journey of a customer before they got on the train. And after they got off the train at the other end, there was an equal number of touch points in the journey of that customer. But you own the train, so what are you going to do? Improve the train service? Well, that's nice, but that's a product-centric view of what's going on. Customer experience-centric view is what's happening in the entire journey. And what do I need to touch the customer and be relevant to the customer and create value for the customer at every point in that journey? That's the difference. Now, what's that mean in our business? Well, we have a product called a retirement village. There is a whole lot of other things going on around customer problems and aspirations that are outside of the retirement village. And if I don't have those pieces, what do I have to do? What I have to do is I build an ecosystem. This is the Apple ecosystem. What's the reason you love your iPhone? Because it's a nice phone? Absolutely not. What makes that phone useful for you? What makes the phone useful for you? And the same question for an Android phone. It's not the hardware. What is it? What makes it useful for you? It's the apps and the content and the payment system and the experience of being able to access all of your data anywhere, anytime. That's an ecosystem. How much of that does Apple own? You know, Apple's the largest seller of software, but it owns no software. It's the largest seller of the world of software, but it owns no software. It's all coming from somebody else. And they did that, why? Because there used to be a thing called BlackBerry. And BlackBerry was designed to do what? One thing really well, email. And BlackBerry taught people about mobile computing. Got people hooked on mobile computing, computing on the go. But there was a problem with the BlackBerry, which was, I've got to carry two devices. I've got to carry one for work, one for pleasure. And the only thing I can do on it is email. My aspiration is to do what? Everything. So there was an unsolved customer problem, and it took Apple to see that aspiration and to realize that to fulfill that aspiration, you have to build an ecosystem. That ecosystem destroyed BlackBerry, the product you all loved and would never let go of. Okay? We're going to see a lot more of this ecosystem level competition. The entire healthcare industry is moving in this direction. Again, back to big data. We've got companies in healthcare mapping your gene sequence, individual gene sequence. You can get that for $500. But now we've got all the real world companies collecting the real world data, the Apples of the world, the Googles of the world, the digitized hospitals. They're collecting the real world data of what's happening based on your real world condition. And they're integrating it into really big models that are doing amazing things in terms of predicting healthcare problems, but also how to treat them dynamically. Genentech. Genentech is a company, biotech company, leading biotech company in cancer. They're developing what's called the living label. What is the living label? Living label. Okay, who is taking a cholesterol drug? Anybody taking a cholesterol drug? It's all right, you can say so. Yeah, right. Okay. Get lots of exercise, sleep well, stay away from stress. You know you go to see your doctor tests your cholesterol how often? How often do they test it? Once a year? You go for an annual physical? Is there anything else that might be affecting your cholesterol on a day-to-day basis? Your diet? Your exercise? Your stress level? Right. But your doctor only knows what? Your cholesterol level once a year. So based on that one point reading, what do? They issue a script and you take it to the, you know, the chemist, and the chemist gives you the drug, and you take the same dose every single day for the next 12 months. What if your cholesterol was changing every single day? Would it be a smart thing to take the same old dose based on an average condition? No. What's happening with the living label? That's a live medicine bottle sitting in your home. And the instructions on how much to take is being updated daily based on all of the other information they're collecting about you. Is that cool? Right. Welcome to the future of big data. All right. So we are going to have to figure out how to create and participate in these new ecosystems that reach beyond our concept of how we create value around a product called a retirement village or even an aged care service offering, right? Fourth big shift is the value chain. Where is most of the value being created in the value chain? Everyone has a value chain. These are the activities you perform, and hopefully it creates value for somebody, and there you get paid. Most companies have focused on what's called the upstream activities in the value chain when they try to innovate and do things better. This is my picture of the upstream activities in running a retirement village. We're always researching, we're looking for new offerings, how to improve our existing offerings, we're doing customer surveys, we're trying to broaden the customer base, we're improving our information systems, we're doing maintenance work, purchasing, outsourcing of services, staff training and development, we're doing reception service, hall service, room service, additional services, booking services, communication, public relations, customer database. Those are called upstream activities, and everybody has focused on those things as the way to become successful. That's all shifting to downstream. What is downstream? That's the shift in thinking from what else can we make and sell to what else can we do for our customers. It's shifting the focus of innovation to the customer, to the very end of the chain, and figuring out what can I do that will create more value for that customer and make them more loyal. Whether it means having an ecosystem, whether it means expanding the scope or changing the scope of my business, we really don't know. But there's sort of three major areas of activity which we care about, right? Shaping customer perceptions, innovating around customer experience, and building a cumulative advantage around the knowledge of that customer that nobody else has. Why is innovation and value shifting to that instead of all the upstream stuff? Because we've been doing the upstream stuff for how long? Decades. We've pretty much squeezed most of what we can out of that. The technology that Chris and Steve were referring to is technology that's allowing you to innovate downstream. Give customers new experiences, and I'm going to explain how that works. So how should marketers respond to these big tectonic shifts? Well, you know, this is the old model. The old model of exchange, there's your customer in the blue, that's you on the in the orange. Customer, give me money, I'll give you a good product and good service. Well, that worked when the customer was naive. Unfortunately, the customer's not naive anymore. So now, the name of the exchange is this. It's called a dynamic learning relationship. Now we want to know everything about our customers. So now we're out there asking customers to tell us everything, right? You get asked every single day, right? Somebody wants to know all about you, and they want to track you, and they want to know everything there is to know. Now, why would you give that data to anybody? Why? Why would you tell people about your needs, your expectations, your wants, your preferences, your behavior? Why would you do that? We know everybody wants it, but why would you do that? Tell me, when do you share your information with a vendor or a provider? When do you do that? Anytime you're ordering it online, so it might be happening without you knowing it. But if you had the choice and you said, well, I'll give it to these people, but not to these people, who would you give it to? You give it to people who would do something that helps you, right? Benefits you. So this is the other side of the value proposition today, right? The value proposition, yes, you've got to have a good product and good service, but now there's another part of the value proposition, which is, hey, give me that data about you, and I will do something for you that nobody else has done. That is what? You have more information about somebody, what are you going to do with it that actually benefits the customer? The first thing you're going to do is tailor the offering, right? So we already know that in aged care, there are people out there already trying to match you to the carer that you like. They're not just giving you a carer that suits the convenience of the provider. They're actually collecting data around people's needs and preferences for a care experience, and they're matching you up against carers that will provide that experience. And that's benefiting the carer and it's benefiting the patient. We already know that is happening. We're going to see a lot more of that tailoring. And if you don't tailor, then the risk of your offering being relevant decreases. The reason we have to tailor is because we're after segments of one. That's another one of the big tectonic shifts in marketing, right? Segments of one. Actually, what's the smallest segment you can have? What is the smallest market segment you can have? One what? One person? No. One need of one person. One need of one person. You're going out to Sydney Airport, you're going to fly somewhere tomorrow, you're flying on business, what's important to you? What's that? Well, that's a general preference, we don't crash. But if you're flying on business, what do you care about? On time. The next day you're going out there again with your family and you're going on vacation to Bali, what's important to you? Or what kind of drinks they serve on the way to Bali, right? Because you're in a different, you just change segments. You're flying the same product, but what happened is your needs and preferences have just changed. That's where this tailoring is coming in. Who knows the most about what the nature of that need is on a dynamic basis, and who's got the flexible organization that can react to that? Flexibility is key, mass customization is key, not efficiency, right? And the other thing you're gonna do is you're gonna give them a differentiated experience and you're gonna teach them something they don't know. This thing called knowledge, well, let's see how this thing works. Basically, the way this thing works is we need a customer database, we need to know everything about our customers. We need a knowledge database, which means we can teach the customer something new. And we need a filtering algorithm, which basically says, take this piece of information and give it to that customer, right? And teach them something new, right? Ziploc. Anyone use Ziploc bags? Right. Two questions for you. After Google, what is the number one search destination on the web? What's the number one, number two, after Google? Google's number one search engine. What's number two?
YouTube.
Go to YouTube and enter Ziploc. How many things will it find? 17,000. How many of those videos on YouTube have been created by Ziploc? One. Do you know there's 16,999 videos of people doing strange things with Ziploc bags on YouTube? Guess who's creating this knowledge that might be useful for your customer? Customers creating the knowledge base. And they're going to create it, whether you like it or not. And so the challenge for marketers is, wow, what do we do? Let people hijack that conversation and hijack that knowledge base, or do we get in there and curate that knowledge base? But we do need a knowledge database. It's not sufficient just to have a customer database. You've got to give something back. What are you going to give back? You're either going to give a tailored offering, a tailored experience, differentiated experience, or you're going to offer them this knowledge that they cannot get from other people. And a lot of that knowledge is being created by the customer. Now, these are the capabilities we need for that. What are we going to do with this platform? What we're going to do with this platform is we're going to use that platform to understand the customer differently and better, connect to them better, and engage them better. When we say engage the customer, what do we mean? We're going to entertain them, we're going to educate them, we're going to solve real value by solving real problems for them, and we're going to get them to participate. Very quickly, let's look at some of these. If I want to understand what's happening in a market, you could do this tomorrow in the retirement village market, by the way. I just did this earlier this week, sat down. I thought, well, let me have a look at what I can learn without even not talking to a customer. So I'm going to observe what's happening in a market. I'm going to go to, for example, I'll go to Google Trends. And I'm interested in the topic of gluten-free because a lot of people are talking about gluten-free. Okay, so what I find on Google Trends is I find the number of searches for the term gluten-free over a five-year period. What do you learn from that? Well, not very much. Yeah, there's a few spikes in there and a few more people are starting to talk about gluten-free. Let me do a deeper dive. I do a deeper dive and I find a rising number of hits associated with the search for gluten-free for Weet-Bix. The number of searches for Weet-Bix has gone up by 1,700%. Would that be interesting? Okay, something's going on there. What's going on? Any idea? Well, maybe Weet-Bix is a gluten-free product, therefore, you know, that's it. The story is, well, that's one of the best gluten-free products. Great, we're all done. My question for you is, you're the product manager for Weet-Bix. What are you going to do with this information? You're the product manager for Weet-Bix. What are you going to do with this information? How are you going to change your marketing strategy? Well, of course, what you're going to do is you're going to do a deeper dive behind this. So we're going to click on Weet-Bix. And when we click on Weet-Bix, we find that there's another search term that is closely related to the searches for Weet-Bix. People who are searching for Weet-Bix are also searching for a thing called lunchboxes. What's that? Huh? Children, very good. You must have children. We need to know more about this. What's going on? Well, let's click on lunchbox, and we're going to click on lunch. Oh, by the way, these peaks and valleys are starting to get sharper. When I click on lunchbox, I'm going to find a pattern in the searches for information about lunchboxes. There's a really clear pattern now in the searches for information about lunchbox. What's behind those peaks? When does the searches for lunchbox spike? They spike like clockwork. What's going on? It's parents panicking the day before the kids are going back to school, thinking, oh, I better make sure my kid has a healthy lunchbox. You're the manager of Weet-Bix. I want you to come up with a promotion for Weet-Bix that appeals to gluten-free sensitive customers, which happen to be parents. Oh, by the way, living in Sunshine Coast and Hobart. People who care about gluten-free do not exist in Sydney. And so I click on lunchbox, and what's associated with lunchbox? Well, they're searching for a thing called Yumbox. What is Yumbox? I don't know, Yumbok, I never heard of it. But it turns out it was a product introduced into Australia in 2013, and it's a kid's lunchbox with portion control. Five little compartments or six little compartments with portions. Tell me who the customer is that's buying this. What, not just parents. Parents with little kids who are really interested in giving the kid a healthy diet in all dimensions. Not just giving them gluten-free, but what? Controlling the portion, making what's going in that line. Somebody write the promotion. What kind of partnership promotion am I going to have if I'm the product manager of Weet-Bix? Who's the first person I'm going to call now? I'm calling Yumbox. Because the sales of Yumbox spike. The sales of Yumbox follow a similar pattern. Here's Yumbox inquiries, right? It launched in 2013. Look at what's happening to Yumbox. Searches for Yumbox. They're occurring at the same time, beginning of the school period, and they're rising. That's becoming a more popular brand. So you see, I'm product manager of Weet-Bix. I had no idea this was going on. First of all, I didn't even realize my product was that important to people caring about gluten-free. I didn't know where those gluten-free people were. I didn't know what else they're doing, and now I know. How long did this take me to do this? About half a day. Right? New tools to understand customers without even asking them anything. Right, what else am I going to do? Now I'm going to connect. Here's what I'm going to do. The problem with most marketers is we talk about the stuff on the left. We are feature-driven. We have a product, we've got features. We've got a village, we're going to tell the customer about the living options, the location, the medical options, the village services, the facilities. Okay, that's all very nice, but the problem is that's not how I'm choosing. I'm choosing on the basis of emotion. What I need to do as a product guy or as a marketer is I need to take my features and I need to connect them to experiences that customers care about. Volvo. You own Volvo. How many different features are there that you can talk about on Volvo? There's about 500 features you can talk about. What did Volvo do? Volvo went to YouTube. They found 6 billion hours of video on YouTube. 6 billion hours. And they matched every single feature to one of those videos. So for example, if you were searching for the weather, right? You know you go to YouTube and they show you a little ad at the front, right? You go to YouTube and they show you like a 5 or 10 second ad at the front. Volvo's trying to figure out what do I put in that ad before somebody watches the rest of the video. So imagine you go to a video to find out something about severe weather. Okay, good. Volvo's going to put a 5 or 10 second ad in front of that, talking about one of their features. What feature of a Volvo car would be relevant to somebody searching for weather? Safety. Yeah, what else? Auto wipers. Very good. You're on the Volvo team. You're on the new marketing team. Watch this video. What you're watching in this video is they're taking the features of Volvo and they're mapping it to 6 billion hours of video. Oh, wrong one.
out of you. The blue shoes.
Right, how much work is involved in that? A lot of work, right? What am I trying to do in that exercise? I'm trying to bring the boring discussion of the features of my product into a context that I know is really relevant and emotional for a customer, right? That's just an example. Next one, what are we gonna do? We're gonna engage the customer in ways we didn't do before. Let's talk about that. First thing we're gonna do, of course, is we're going to entertain them. You know, what's the beauty of YouTube? Somebody tell me the beauty of YouTube. What can you do on YouTube that you otherwise couldn't do before? You used to have to go and hire a really expensive advertising agency and a media company, and you had to pay a lot of money to promote your product in any kind of video notion. Now you have YouTube, what can you do?
Feedback.
Well, you can get feedback, but the first thing you can do is you can have people tell stories about your product. And it doesn't cost you a lot of money to make that video and costs you nothing to distribute it. All right. I'm going to show you a video about a story that was on YouTube. I want you to tell me who the company is.
Давай пошли. Ой, осторожней.
P&G, proud sponsor of Moms.
Would you have picked P&G as the maker of that video? What are they telling you in that story? That's not on TV, that's something they ran before the Olympics. You went and searched for Olympics on YouTube, you got this story. What story are they telling you? Behind every successful athlete is what? A mother. Okay, unfortunately, I don't have time to tell you the results of this, but that's one of the highest watched videos ever in history. And the lift in the brand recognition and sales of P&G in the back of it was exceptional. The thing I want to share with you is that when the business that you're in, when you're selling experiences, you're selling stories. You're telling stories about the experiences people have before your village, in the village, in the rest of their life that they want to share with other people. And to do that now is really cheap and really easy to do given the technology that's there. How do we make our customers smarter?
Okay.
Hey, sis.
How are you?
So let's get started.
Yeah.
You just move your head and it looks around. That's so cool.
Let's do the test drive. This is amazing.
Hi, my name's David. How can I help you guys today?
Thank you for helping me. This is so cool.
Toyota, let's go places.
Can anyone envision a version of that for a retirement village? Somebody searching for a retirement village? What would that experience be like? What would somebody be able to do in a collaboration forum like that where you can access help online at any time, talk to a real person? What would that experience be like in the search for a retirement village? Or once you're in a retirement village and you're searching for other things that are part of your experience in a retirement village? Okay? My last one, because we're running out of time, and I think this is really key. This is all about getting people to participate. I want you to imagine you run a funeral home. How are you going to market funerals? What would you do? How would you market funerals? When would you start marketing funerals? Anyone got any great ideas about how to market a funeral service? Oh, right. What do they do when they get together at the funeral? I just went to one this week. What do? We go to the service and then we go have a wake. And what happens in the wake? What happens in the wake is we tell stories about what a wonderful person that was, right? Celebrate their life. Can anyone see an opportunity? When are we celebrating their life? When are we doing that? When they're gone, right? When they're dead. Can anyone think of another time to celebrate their life? Oh, well, they're alive. Okay, here we go.
The most beautiful words are often spoken when someone has passed away. Such a shame, because the person they talk about can no longer hear them. For the funeral insurance company Daler, we came up with an idea. Why wait until it's too late? Say something wonderful today. We gave people the opportunity to say something wonderful to someone they really care about, and they were completely taken by surprise. We filmed speeches with hidden cameras and created some extraordinary commercials with real people, no actors, honest and sincere.
Ik wil graag iets opdragen aan mijn lieve ouders die hier zitten. Bedankt mam en pap dat jullie je leven in Iran hebben achtergelaten voor mij. Om mij een leven te kunnen bieden waar ik altijd van heb gedroomd. En waarvan ik nooit had gedacht dat het werkelijkheid zou worden. Ik wil jullie heel erg bedanken voor jullie moed en jullie doorzettingsvermogen. En voor alles wat jullie voor mij hebben gedaan.
Pa, ik wil je bedanken voor de mooie jaren hier. En dat niet alleen. Ik ben nu een aantal maanden getrouwd en je hebt mij enorm geholpen met klussen. Eigenlijk sta je altijd voor me klaar. Pa, ik zeg het niet vaak, maar ik hou van je.
Je bent een super zoon in moeilijke tijden en in gewone tijden. Dankjewel, lieve jongen.
Then we gave everyone in Holland the chance to show their love and affection. We made ads with just the word dear. You were invited to fill in the rest yourself. The people of the Netherlands made immense use of this opportunity and uploaded their beautiful words to our special website. You could also share your words via the website or via Facebook. But we went further. From the written ads, we made posters for outdoor. Each poster was unique and was displayed in the area where the person it was meant for lived. And we went even further. On New Year's Eve, we gave people the chance to express their love live on TV. A wave of beautiful words swept over Holland, and we got the message across. It was picked up, talked about, and acted on. And the result? Daler captured a place in the list of top 10 best-known brands in Holland, and the amount of insured capital grew by 50%. But the best result is that Holland grew a bit more beautiful. Why wait until it's too late? Say something wonderful today. Daler, for each other.
Okay, can anyone see a version of that for retirement village residents? How many times did you hear the reference to their insurance products in that story, in that experience? Well, actually, in the actual community participation, you never heard it, right? Okay, people keep talking about creating experiences. You just saw a great example of what it means to create experiences for people in an industry that is incredibly close to our own. Look, I'm out of time. I just want to leave you with one last challenge. No talk on marketing would be complete without this discussion of how to build an innovation-driven organization. This topic, the ugly topic of digital disruption. I'm just going to leave you with this one challenge. One slide, I think, says a great deal about what it means to innovate in this industry. Here are eight well-known businesses that have clearly considered to be disruptors. I just want you to take note of a common theme in that list. Uber, world's largest taxi company, owns no taxis. Airbnb, world's largest provider of accommodation, owns no real estate. Skype, world's largest phone company, owns no telecom infrastructure. Alibaba, world's most valuable retailer, owns no inventory. Facebook, most popular media owner, owns no content. Society One, world's fastest growing bank, owns no money. Netflix, world's largest movie house, owns no cinemas. And Apple and Google, world's largest software vendors, owns no software. Retirement Village, largest retirement village provider in the world, owns what? If you follow this logic, owns no villages. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, that's where I will leave it. Thank you very much for allowing me to be here. I look forward to any questions you might have afterwards because I think we're over time. But I will be here if you have any further comments or questions. Thank you very much.
Can I just ask? Thank you very much, Peter. And always challenging conversations that Peter presents. I'm not going to let you get off so easily, and we haven't had a discussion about this, but I know that Peter has been working on in a home with a major not-for-profit in the home care sector in 2016. These are all great things, Peter, but I know many people in the audience will be saying, gee, I'd love to be doing something as smart and clever and so on as that, but you know, when I go back to the office, you know, our business, how are we going to do that? You know, do I have to get, you know, we haven't got people who are as creative as that. I know from our discussions that the emotion in home care is a massive thing. So yes, we do have the emotion, but for the people here in the audience, what can they do when they go back to the office? Seriously, because, you know, we'd all love to do it, but how do we do it? Well, what's the first step?
I think the message that I want you to take from today is all of the technology and platforms that I've just shown you are openly available and really cheap. Most of this stuff was being done on YouTube. Has anybody ever loaded a YouTube video up? Right. How complicated is that? Not really, right? So I think what the challenge is not the technology or the access to the platforms, it's just our ability to conceptualize that we're actually selling this experience and not the village. And that experience has got many, many parts to it. So I think any one of us could sit down and say, okay, let's take a look at what those high-level problems and aspirations of our customers are, or our potential customers are, and let's start thinking about what a complete experience would be and what an ecosystem might be, a group of partners. An ecosystem is just a group of partners, right? You already run an ecosystem, whether you know it or not, right? You're using carers to provide care, right? You've got service providers embedded into your ecosystem. So I think it's just taking some of the resources that we have and broadening it out to a higher level of thinking about how we want to be relevant to our customers. And what you see in all of these things is they step away from the product, they start telling a story, and that story is very wide-ranging, and it's appealing to people's emotions, not just their logic.
I would think from my own experience, and we have to do this every day in our media group, is just sitting down with a piece of paper and, you know, actually writing it out, because we all know this stuff, don't we?
Yeah. I didn't. If you can just bring this back, just to prove the point, Chris says I've done work in in Australia in this space. This is actually a mapping of programs and offerings and initiatives in a very large care organization in Australia. What is being shown here is the current things that they're offering. And this portfolio is showing you the relevance and the uniqueness of those things. The horizontal axis is showing you sustaining innovation versus disruptive. Sustaining is basically an attempt to improve anything that already exists. So remember, I was talking about your value chain, and you're going through and you're trying to improve your existing facility and your existing service offerings. That's all the stuff on the left. And some of it's unique and some of it's not unique, right? If we talk about looking for new opportunities to create value that, you know, might reframe how people think about value and reframe how they think about the experiences with us, we're not going to get there by just improving what already exists. We're going to have to do what Chris says. We're going to have to take a blank piece of paper. We're going to have to map out these best imaginable experiences which don't exist. And basically, that's taking a problem or an aspiration that a customer has that has never been solved, right? So if we're going to design your village from ground zero with a blank piece of paper and there were no constraints, and we're going to address a really critical set of problems or aspirations of your customers that had never been solved before, what would that look like? I would love to tell you what we found in this research, but this research has been done in aged care in Australia. It's commercial in confidence, so I can't reveal to you the actual detail, but what I can show you is that those opportunities exist. These are the new opportunities that were discovered, so it's showing you the number of opportunities that were discovered, that could potentially reframe value in the aged care industry in Australia. Right? The message I want you to take from this is really simple. These are things that have never been addressed. They've either never been recognized, they're needs of a customer that have never been addressed before or never been recognized. And I want you to take one message from this slide, and that is, I don't care how well you know your customers. I don't care how well you think you are creating value. There is always something you haven't seen. There's always something you haven't addressed. And those are the opportunities that exist for people to disrupt the industry and for you to establish a different relationship with the customer if you're able to deliver and address some of these things, right? So what I'm getting at is, Chris is right. We need to take this blank piece of paper. We need to sit down and start thinking about how we might address problems and aspirations of our customers that have never been addressed before. And that's the pathway to reframing value and building loyalty in the customer base. So, yeah.
Okay, thank you very much. We're reaching into coffee time, but can I just have a final point? And this may be a bit crude of me, but villages.com.au, we have, as we saw yesterday, 80,000 plus people a month coming to our website. In the last 14 months, we have had two videos loaded up to our website by clients. For us to be able to get decent photography, still photography of individual retirement villages that are paying to be on our website, is extremely hard. I would say one client in 100 would update their photographs each year on our website. My point being that as a sector, our marketing people are not doing a very good job. Hate to tell you, but that's a fact. So The cost to do a video like was done by Mentor Ellison yesterday, you know, the illustration one. Emma, I'm looking at you. How much is that software? Couple of $100 for that software, and you can create the videos yourself in an hour. So there's no excuses. So the opportunity exists to reframe.
Very good.
Best imaginable experience.
We'll wait until we see it from somebody in the audience.
And we'll see what happens next year. Can we show our appreciation to Peter Wilkins?